Welcome to the March 30, 2017 meeting of the Sherborn Board of Selectmen. Having called the meeting to order, we'll ask Town Administrator David Williams to please read the agenda and add anything for amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, we'll add topics not reasonably anticipated by the Chair 48 hours in advance, and I'm not aware of any of those items. Then a period of public comment, and we have three signed up for public comment. Then the consideration of waiver of promoter's license fee for the Friends of the Sherborn Library Arts and Craft Fair for May 13th. Public hearing at 6:15 p.m. for transfer of retail packaged goods store license. And consideration of ballot questions for town election. Consideration of 2017 annual town meeting warrant articles, department budgets, and capital items as needed. There aren't any of those needs that I'm aware of. Then operational items, the town administrator report, CM&D director job description, hiring process, and interim director position. Announced Clean Sherborn Day for April 29th. And selectmen reports, meeting calendar, next meetings April 13th and April 25th. Consideration of minutes of January 5th, 2017 and January 26th, 2017. And then an executive session under MGL Chapter 30A, Section 21.3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and school union contract negotiations.
Okay, any amendments to that? No, do we have a motion to approve that?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Okay, great. The agenda is approved. We've accomplished something. Now it's time for public comment. And first is our collector, Nancy Hess.
Okay, I am just here to tell people that the real estate tax bills that are due May 1st have been mailed, and if they expected one and didn't get one, they should either get in touch with us or go online to see what that bill is. It's due May 1st. We'll have extended hours that day, so we will be open till 6, but we always urge people to please pay early rather than later. It helps not only with the town finances and cash flow, but it also helps not jam up the office at the end of the pay period. Everybody should have gotten one of these stuffers in their with their tax bill. At the bottom is the tax aid donation form, which helps with the elderly or disabled, low-income people who have a difficult time meeting their tax obligation. And on the back, and it was not a mistake that it was made upside down, it's so that you could use this form and you could use this form and still be able to do your farm pond stickers as well as make a contribution to the tax aid fund. So I would just urge everybody to pay early and pay often.
Great. Thank you. Okay, next is Addie Mae Weiss from Housing Partnership.
I just wanted to quickly say thank you to everyone in the town who came to the March 7th Housing Forum. It was a really great turnout, and I think we had a lot of good feedback and confident that we got a wide range of interests to represent a strong plan for Sherborn. I wanted to give the update on the timeline. We've set a goal date of May 15th for the Housing Partnership to post the final draft on the town's website. And this is a final draft, and it's a draft, so there still will be, we're hoping people in town will take a look at it, and we are accepting feedback from that draft stage. And then a presentation of the final draft, we have anticipate Jennifer Goldson, the Housing Production Plan consultant, to present to the Board of Selectmen and Planning Board on May 25th. Basically going through step by step on the plan. And I wanted to kind of clarify or just set the expectation that I was reading something about business plans, and an economist was saying that they shouldn't be called strategic plans, they really should be called strategic guesses. This plan is non-binding. It is our best guess of how we see a map to adding affordable housing. The same with the general plan that the planning board's been working on. This is a lot of great input, a lot of good ideas. There's probably ideas in there that will never work, but they're our best guesses, and it's kind of compiled in one document so that we have something to work from. And then if a plan is to be acted on, at that point, there will be a vetting process. No action that's listed in any of these documents is going to be done without a proper vetting through town and town meetings and all the normal procedures. So there's no single group making an action that's, without the town input. So that was basically it. Just wanted to give the expectation, and we are hoping to have the Board of Selectmen and Planning Board approve the final draft by the end of May, so we can get the document to the state for approval by mid-June. So,
thank you. Thanks for all the hard work on that too, and for leading that effort.
Thank you, guys.
Okay, and Daryl Beardsley from the Board of Health.
Hi, I just have two quick things. We, based on the meeting with advisory a couple Saturdays ago, we put in two requests for reserve fund transfers. First one is the most time sensitive, and that has to deal with general chemical funding for the agent, since that responsibility, you asked that it be moved over to Board of Health, so I don't know if that, it seems like it would be good form to have your approval on that. And just to confirm it so that advisory could move ahead, some of the, if you haven't heard, there's been a change of the status with General Chemical in that they have ceased operations, they no longer have staff, and there is a certain pot of money, about $1.8 million, that is to be turned over to the state to be used for whatever remains to be done there. And so we're trying to, we've had some meetings with various town representatives and legislative representatives and MassDEP, but we're trying to plot out how that money might be used so that both Framingham's needs and Sherborn's needs can be met. So I don't know if there's any way to add that to your agenda today. That would be great. Otherwise, sooner the better, because really there's another meeting next week, and we just want to make sure that we're covered and taken care of moving ahead. And then the other one may not be as critical. I don't know if it needs your explicit approval. It's had your informal endorsement in the past, and that was for the mounding study. And the sooner that's approved, the sooner we can move ahead with that.
Great. Yes, so if you need reserve fund transfers, those have to go on an agenda. When are we having those on the agenda, David?
We can do it April 13th. We also have a discussion about this on the April 13th agenda.
Great.
Can I?
John?
Prior to the reserve fund, it doesn't seem to me that they're out of money in their budget, so that shouldn't hold up the agent if there's work to be done right now, correct?
Right.
In regards to General Chemical.
Right.
Right, and we have been taking care of that. I mean, we've had several meetings already.
Right.
We just want to make sure that we're spending appropriately.
Of course,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But timely work is timely work.
I have some views about what to do about the General Chemical situation, which I could take the rest of the evening talking about. But we haven't been plugged in to any formal process, as far as I know, on this. But where I'd like to see this go is to have a request made to the United States to take over this site, as we've done in other communities. They have the ability to track down the investors in General Chemical, the corporate structure, and find somebody who has money so that this thing can be cleaned up correctly. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts won't do that. They don't do it very aggressively. But I've had great success with the Superfund people for other sites.
The DEP's taking that position that they're going to request the EPA to identify it as a Superfund site, whether or not they will now, particularly with where their funding is, who knows. Darrell, I had two quick questions. General Chemical was sold to a Canadian company, I think it's ChemCorp, based in Toronto, a few years ago. I have no idea if it was an asset sale or what happened to the liabilities, but I would love to get more information. What time is this meeting, the meeting next week?
Right now it's tentatively scheduled for Wednesday morning, but an exact time hasn't been set up. And I guess another piece of this is that it would be nice to have Drew Smythe there as well.
Yeah.
Again, no firm decisions being made, but just to start to look at what the pool of money is and how much the different pieces might cost and how this might break down, because of course, with the school and the residential neighborhood next door, Framingham has some very immediate concerns, and Sherborn has concerns that will emerge or starting to emerge, and
I think
we need protection as well.
I think we can't go into a long discussion of this issue under public comment. We can put it on another agenda.
Could you just forward me the timing for that meeting?
Okay.
Great. Thanks very much.
Send it to me too, please.
Thanks for the input.
Okay.
Good. Okay. Now
and
we're
just,
on.
And Paul, what you mentioned was discussed at the large meeting that was held a couple weeks ago. So.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Next we're on a consideration of the waiver of promoter's license fee for the Friends of Sherborn Library Arts and Crafts Fair.
So moved. This is a no-brainer. We've agreed generally to do that.
Second.
For all of these kinds of activities within the town. No reason to exclude this event, which is a fundraiser for the library.
Okay, can we maybe talk a little bit about this event, which this year is at the Jameson Fields on Saturday, March 13th, between 10
May
and 14.
May.
That's May? Oh, wow. May 14th, between 10 a.m. and
13th.
Mike's ready to go. Saturday, May 13th. Saturday, May 13th, 2017, between the hours of, I got that right, between the hours of 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. But it's at Jameson Field this year. And it's always a good event.
There are two items that they were asking for. It was to waive the fee for the promoter's license, and the building fee for the tents that are being used, and also permission to place yard signs in various locations around Sherborn.
Do we have any authority to waive building permit fees? I'm not sure that's anything that's within
yeah,
the
I think you do. You do, because I think
purview.
Sometimes the selectmen do it on their own things. Library permit. So you do have authority to waive them.
Yeah, just because we do it.
I don't see that one. What's the building permit fee for? A tent?
Yeah, the tent.
Tent direction, yeah.
And we've waived that. We've waived it for the fire department.
So I amend my motion to include waiving of the building fee and the placement of the signs in the usual location where signs have been placed before.
Second.
All in favor? Okay, good. What do we have next? We have
a public hearing.
Public hearing at 6:15.
We're just about there.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to read the legal notice?
And noticing in this letter from the Friends of Sherborn Library, they also asked us for permission to do overflow parking at the highway garage, porta potties at the fields.
There are other.
I'm not sure that's our purview. That sounds like
right.
Recreation Commission for the.
Yeah, we're taking
care
of the rest of
okay.
the items.
Great.
But those were the only items that needed specific items.
I would be interested.
Porta potties are not in our jurisdiction.
Dan, I would be interested in knowing the answer to what authority we have to waive these permit fees. Not that it's not a good idea, it's just I'm not aware of any.
It's the building inspector who has no authority to waive the fees.
He does.
There's only one person who has no authority to waive the fees.
I would say there is no one in the town who has the authority to waive the fees except for the agency that approves the fees to begin with. And we're the agency that finally sets the fees. And therefore, we're the only agency in town that can waive it.
You have an opinion on that?
It's the statute. It's 40, section 22.
That's exactly what I was looking for. I'm looking for the statute.
Section, chapter 40, section 22.
Oh, we killed too much time. Okay.
Now it's time.
Yeah, I'm going to read the...
late.
No public notice. The Sherborn Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing on Thursday, March 30, 2017 at 6:15 in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 19 Washington Street, on the application of Royal Bengal Corporation, DBA Sherborn Wine and Spirits, Catherine Coughlin, manager, for the transfer of a retail packaged goods store license to sell all kinds of alcoholic beverages at 29A North Main Street. Oral and written comments are invited. We have a notice list, and Gene, these notices were all sent out?
They were.
Okay, and this notice was published?
It was.
Yep, and here's the publication. Very good. So, everything's in order, Gene, as far as the application goes?
Yep.
Okay, great. Can we have the applicants come up to the table and introduce themselves, please? Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Catherine Coughlin, and I'm the applicant appearing on behalf of Royal Bengal Corporation to petition this board for approval of the transfer of the liquor license currently held by Watkins Group for the Sherborn Wine and Spirits.
Okay. You have experience in running packaged liquor stores before? Or?
Experience in the restaurant business, but a long time ago.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that was my question. You had checked off the box that said that you hadn't had previous experience with a package store.
That's correct.
And I wanted to lecture you a little bit about how important it is with the sale of alcohol to strictly comply with the laws. We as a community want to be sure that the liquor laws are upheld. We're particularly concerned that alcohol not get sold to underage individuals. There are programs that train selling people, sales people, as to how to check identification, how to identify false and counterfeit identification, all those kinds of things. Nothing in your application indicated that you had any experience with that or that you had taken any courses along those lines. And so while I'm in support of the transfer of the license, I am concerned with your lack of experience and would very much like to hear you say some commitment to getting the training that you need in order to do this. This is a serious undertaking.
Yes, sir. If I could address that. I do take this very seriously. And so when I considered purchasing a package store or a wine and spirit store, one of the first things I did was look into the Mass Pack. I asked Mr. Watkins if his store or if he or his corporation were a member of Mass Pack so that I could get a discount for employees. Because the liquor license hasn't transferred, I am not eligible to be a member of the Massachusetts Package Store Association, but I am registered to take a course on April 17th. All of my employees, as part of the manual, I've put together an employee manual. Every employee who's employed at that store will be required to have tip certification before they're hired. I also have been investigating point of sale software. The point of sale software, there are two systems I'm looking at. One system allows for the scanning of driver's license to actually record if someone appears to be under 30 and they're asked for identification. It can scan the barcode on the back to determine whether it's a real driver's license or a real military ID, and it also records the person's name and birth date. That information is kept for 7 days with the system that I'm looking at. It also provides at the top of the terminal screen the date for the birth date upon by which somebody could purchase. That changes every day. Alcohol and cigarettes. There's a tobacco license also. A cigarette license at that location. So it's something I take very seriously. I've done a lot of investigation. I'd like to meet with the police chief and find out if he has any concerns specifically in this town. I've spent a lot of time talking to Rob Watkins, the current owner, asking him what types of issues he's had. By way of explanation, I'm very involved in community service and Natick, and while I have not been involved selling alcohol, my record as a member in community service and Natick and volunteer work shows that I'm very committed to community, and these types of things are very important to me. So all employees will have TIPS training, the two-hour training either at the location that's provided by MassPacs, or there are two-hour training online. I'd prefer someone take the training in person, but those are only offered about once a month. So I have looked at legal liability issues very seriously, not just from a not just from the perspective of liability and losing a license, but also for, you know, maintaining community standards and making sure that there isn't tobacco or alcohol being sold to minors or people who are under the age, the appropriate age.
Okay, good. Do we have any public comments? Do we have any more board comments?
Well, I would say that Sherborn Wine and Spirits has been a good citizen of the town for a long time. It provides an important amenity to the community. It's a good thing for the community that you're willing to carry on the business. I see you've purchased the, not just the business, but the same name.
Yes.
So from the perspective of our citizenry, it's going to look the same,
yes,
feel the same old place that they're all used to. And all of that is good. We do want to maintain as many amenities in our downtown area as possible. We also do want to give the former owner the ability to exit when his time has come, and I see that provided for here. So I wish him well and thank him for the years. It's been quite a few years that he has provided the service to the community. It's all appreciated. I hope that you will not just carry on the name, but carry on the role in maintaining our little community center there. So I'm in favor of the transfer, but I did want to give you the heads up that if we find kids getting liquor from your establishment, you'll find the smiles today will turn into frowns.
Thank you, Paul.
Yeah, I'm sorry Rob couldn't be here tonight. Rob has been a terrific asset to the town, not just for wine, liquor, and beer, but Beta and VHS rentals. That's how long he's been in town.
That was
one,
yes,
of, one of the sites in town. But Rob's been a good member of the Sherborn business community and the Sherborn community, so hope you can fill those shoes.
I'd like to try.
This was not reviewed by the police department?
She did her own queries, and I did not. This is just an approval. This all has to go to the ABCC. You are not issuing the license tonight. You were just signing the transfer of the license that will go to the ABCC.
Just procedurally on...
Pardon me?
Procedurally on liquor licenses, I personally prefer having a report from the building inspector, police chief, the fire chief, just to make sure that it's safe, the design is safe. This is our opportunity to...
Well, they did, when the board renewed the alcohol, the retail license in January, it went through all those, the building itself went through all those inspections. So we're only talking a couple of months since then, and As far as Kathleen did her own quarry, it's required by the ABCC. I can certainly ask the police chief to do his own background, but I don't know. It's not part of the process of the ABCC transfer of license.
If I could just say something, when the ABCC receives the package, what they're looking for from the town is a notice that you're satisfied that there are no outstanding obligations. You've talked to me, you know who I am, you've reviewed the packet. They'll do the background check. When it comes back to the town, in between tomorrow and when it comes back to the town, we have anywhere between 2 weeks and a month, and I'm happy to arrange meetings with all of these people at the site. I've arranged meetings with, I've met with Mr. Haji Giorgio to talk about assuming the lease and to talk about, we spent a good hour talking about the town and the role that the stores play in the town. I've set up meetings with people regarding the sign to make sure that the sign is, we wanted to change it so that it was all black, so that there was some uniformity, keep the same name, but the front be a little bit more uniform. I've made arrangements for someone to come in and inspect the equipment to make sure that the equipment is, that's next Wednesday, to make sure the equipment is safe and sound, doesn't require any type of major work, and if it does, then I'll make sure that gets taken care of. But I'm very happy to make sure that these types of meetings are scheduled, and these reports make their way back to Jeannie so that they come back before the ABCC returns the file.
Well, as I say, I'm going to vote in favor of the transfer. This is just for the internal staff.
It can be done before you actually, we bring the license forward for you to sign it. I'll send an email out to Rick and to the building inspector, and they will redo their inspection.
And you have negotiations for a new lease underway, is that what you said with the landlord? Because this lease expires tomorrow.
I just picked up minutes before this meeting an extension of that lease for me to assume for the purposes of the ABCC, but I
that's
have
what
a negotiation.
I was wondering. Yeah, okay.
I
good.
Have a negotiation for my.
It's the last page, last packet in.
It is, okay, great.
Yeah.
Good. Anything further from anybody?
Move approval.
All right.
Second.
All in favor? And welcome.
Thank you.
You're taking over another institution in town. We had the folks from Frosty's in here last time.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, there's been a lot of institutions changing hands. So thank you. Welcome.
Look forward
Good luck
to
with the
you.
ABCC.
Thank you so much.
Gene, can we sign this thing that's okay. Assigned here?
Yeah.
Okay, next on our agenda, consideration of ballot questions for town election.
We got a single page handout of the ballot questions.
That's what you sent us earlier.
Third.
So Paul, and I communicated with David about this earlier, the two identical paragraphs under the ballot question, I don't think we need both of those paragraphs.
Well, they're not identical.
Well, they're identical in the sense of zoning and general bylaws. Why would we need a town election vote on a zoning bylaw?
This was drafted by Barbara St. Andre.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Again, I think it's belt and suspenders. She has the yes and no that applies to both. She doesn't have separate yeses and nos. So while it's looks like two paragraphs. It is all one question.
Mm-hmm.
It's just restated in slightly different language so that they track. I mean, that's what we have town council for.
That's a convenient comment. You don't want to be town council. 2 minutes ago, you were citing chapter and verse.
Well, you can see the big difference is the last three words.
Yeah.
One says it's an amendment to the town's general bylaws. The second says it's an amendment to the town's zoning bylaw. The ballot question four that was adopted by the voters was very confused and has all kinds of internal inconsistencies. So in this context, more is better than less. Because if someone says, if our vote gets challenged under one, then the other would survive.
This is a little bit like Where's Waldo, though. I mean, you really got to pour over this thing to figure out what the difference is. Could we say general and zoning bylaws? Get rid of the second paragraph?
You'd have to say and or. I mean, there are other language, and if I was writing the ballot question, I might have written it a little bit different, but they had town council write it, and I can't say that what town council has written is wrong.
I think it's because in that question on the warrant, it was split into an A and B, mm-hmm. and that they both needed to pass. Or
is it possible to either highlight or underline just the three words that are different so people understand what they're reading? Not that anyone's going to read them on the ballot.
I have to believe there's a way to redraft this.
To what?
Just to underline the words general bylaws and zoning bylaws.
Fine with me.
What if you got rid of the question mark at the end of the first one and said, and further, comma?
Well, because they actually stand alone.
It's still, okay.
But there's only one yes or no.
But there's only one yes or no.
Yeah.
Yes, because you can combine questions. So,
but then how is it a vote on either or? It's a vote on both.
You can check yes and no, I guess.
I think it just said only a no, but that's a different issue.
There's a typo here with the capital letter on no also. Can we just get that fixed?
Yeah, why don't we delete no?
I thought the point was to be able to, I thought that's why we separated them. You wanted to have each of them to stand alone. The way it is now, you've got to support both of them. I mean, I'm arguing against my position here because I don't favor either of them, but I thought the whole point was to have a yes-no vote on both pieces.
Do you want to just vote it?
Why don't you put a yes or no after the first one?
Right. I just asked and vote it that that's how you want it if it clears.
And underline for the difference.
Yeah, so underline the difference and add the yes and no lines underneath as long as Barbara doesn't tell us that's wrong.
So for our viewing audience, what we're talking about are ballot questions to prohibit the operation of all types of marijuana establishments for non-medical prescribed use, including marijuana cultivators, marijuana testing facilities, marijuana product manufacturers, manufacturer retailers, or any of the types of licensed marijuana-related businesses here in Sherborn.
So, David, on the other ones, on the bond ones, are these the ones advisories decided to bond?
Yeah, these are the ones the Prop 2.5 exemption is what they're looking
There's
for.
Actually two more because they're looking at everything, and now they have five pieces of capital that they're proposing to bond.
Paul, which are what?
It's the dump. The new ones are a dump truck and the police cruisers. They added that to bonding.
Paul, how come you don't just put everything on the ballot, every capital item?
I just got this from Ben today.
Because we're getting. I have a problem with all of these ballot questions for a couple of reasons. If you want me to launch into it, it's partly an answer to your question. First thing is that I'd like to see what the effect on the tax rate is of each of these questions. And secondly, this is a year in which we had a lot of free cash, and yet we're asking the voters to increase their taxes. There's three questions on this sheet of paper, there's two more. So we're asking, going to the voters and asking them to increase their taxes. Because we're borrowing, I'm going to do debt exclusions. Why can't we do the borrowing within the levy limit? Why do we have to ask people to increase their taxes? And thirdly, when advisory was in here, I said, could we use some of that free cash to make a payment to reduce the tax rate enough to cover at least the first year of all of these borrowing costs so that there would be no tax increase for our citizens? And I don't have an answer for that. That's why at the beginning of the meeting I asked, is advisory going to be here so that we can have that discussion about what is the impact of all of these on the tax rate? It may be that they are going to use some free cash to offset the debt service costs for this year if these things get voted, so that there'll be no net increase from these questions.
I thought advisory voted at the Saturday meeting 2 weeks ago what they were going to recommend as far as capital items and also free cash usage.
I did too.
They did.
Okay, so things changed since then?
They voted last
this
night.
Is what, no. This is, they said they voted at that meeting. I wasn't there, yeah. But Ben, they're doing all their write-ups now, and Ben gave this to me today, and.
So what's the effect on the tax rate?
Well, in the current year, there won't be an impact. So I gave all these bond issues to Heather. She's going to calculate and push it out to see what the impact will be, and she's going to give that to me on Monday. So.
We can, they have it calculated on the impact would be. So are you saying you'd like to amend the language so it says with an estimated tax increase of blank per thousand?
No,
you can't do that. But right now I'm going to vote no on all of these, all five.
Yeah, but you're filling out your ballot. It's not the election. Everybody gets to vote yes or no on those. Advisory.
Only if we put them on the ballot. Has to be a two-thirds vote of this board to put these on the ballot.
Yeah, so what you just handed us has to do with Board of Health. Is there a piece of this that has to do with the budget? The capital items? I don't think so.
Some reserve funds.
This has to do with the reserve fund transfer.
That has to do with the reserve fund transfer.
That's not on the agenda.
For next time, yeah.
Yeah, that's not on the agenda.
Great.
Okay.
But what she has from last night's advisory meeting doesn't match this anyway, so this is kind of pointless. This wasn't updated since yesterday?
Yesterday.
Well, they didn't have, first of all, they didn't meet last night.
They didn't?
No. They postponed the meeting until next Wednesday.
Oh, then we should just postpone this, because we can't do this ahead of them.
You have to do it by April 4th.
And I thought they had done it already.
Whatever, we can't do this without them. This is no good.
That's right? Why I was asking, how come all the projects aren't just listed on there to cover?
I don't know.
I thought this was the result of last night's meeting.
This went out in the packet on Tuesday from Town Council.
Definitely not the result.
The items are.
Last time I talked to George, which I thought was yesterday, was we would get an update from their meeting for our ballot questions, because we're signing off. We don't even know if that's what they want to do at this point.
Yeah.
Because I don't think they voted definitively exactly what they were going to borrow and which items they weren't going to borrow. Did you get that?
He said that they did, yes. George said that they did vote at that meeting on the
18th. At the Saturday meeting, yeah.
He said they did vote, and I can send you a copy of the email. I don't have it with me, but.
Well, maybe that would be a good one to get, so we know exactly what they voted to do.
But you have it.
Yes.
Yeah.
And maybe, Diane, maybe give George a call while you're down there.
George sent an email just before noon today.
So aren't we going to have to schedule a meeting on April the 4th? Is that the deadline?
They have the revised item. They have the dump truck being bonded, police cruisers being bonded.
The dump truck's already on here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they do.
Dump truck. No, the snow fighter's on there. They're not
the
dump truck.
It says the dump truck. It says snow fighter dump truck.
Well, there's a snow fighter, and then there's a one-ton dump truck.
Oh, yeah, that's a pickup truck, isn't it?
It's a dump.
Wait, is that one truck or two?
I think that's one vehicle.
Says
And some of the amounts, and who gets some of the amounts changed?
Well, the amount's not on the ballot. That doesn't matter.
So they have the dump truck at $75,000 to be bonded. The police cruisers at $85,000 to be bonded. Pine Hill Cemetery improvements of $327,000 to be bonded. Snow Fighter of $195,000 to be bonded. And for the road improvements, $160,000 free cash and $290,000 to be bonded.
Yep, that's what they voted the last time. I didn't recall the police cruisers being a bond, though.
No, it's definitely, he has it as a revised list.
Yeah, but we have the Snow Fighter, but we don't have the dump truck.
The dump truck is new to the list, and
I think if you replace the slash with a comma, you have a Snow Fighter, comma, dump truck, and related equipment.
Is there a dollar value there?
Should have been written there.
No, you don't.
They chose to bond the police cruisers.
I'm trying to line them up with the Article 10 listing, which has the Snow Fighter at 195 and the dump truck.
That doesn't,
separate item is 75.
Doesn't make sense. They can't bond the police cruisers. Last year, up until this year, police cruisers are part of the budget because they're disposable.
Well, we're in a three-year rotation, and they can bond it for up to 5 years. So I don't.
It hardly breaks the threshold of capital.
Yeah, I would vote against putting that on the ballot.
Yeah,
I'm not interested in putting that on the ballot. I don't think it makes any sense.
I can reach out to George on that.
But I think we need to take a vote now on what the ballot looks like. So it sounds like we've got road repairs, which is on here. We've got Snow Fighter and a dump truck. So maybe we, instead of the slash, we have to put a comma, a dump truck. So it says a Snow Fighter, comma, a dump truck and related equipment. And then we have the Pine Hill Cemetery.
But in one item, they have the road repairs, maintenance, and improvements. That's two different things. Completely different things.
No.
And
no,
it's
split between...
It's still part of the road budget, isn't it?
Huh?
This is... The improvements is the $260,000 piece. The remainder is the seed money piece. The operating capital.
Okay.
That's what they have.
That's not the building maintenance and improvements.
No. It's road repair. It's road...
So they're going to pay for the 400 and something with free cash?
No, 450, they're going to pay 160 out of free cash and 290 out of bond.
I just flipped to the building maintenance.
Which is a five,
yeah, no,
which
no,
is
no,
a
no,
five,
this,
is not,
this doesn't mean building maintenance and building improvements. Why don't we just say repairs, maintenance, and improvements to roads?
Much better.
Okay. All right, so we've got, I think I've got a markup that reflects what we just discussed.
Can you tell me how you want the tax impact on the ballot?
We don't.
I don't want it on the ballot.
Oh, you wanted to know. Oh, okay.
There isn't enough information.
Yeah. Okay. It's been requested, but we don't have it.
Okay. All right. So this, as so modified, which would be to add a separate yes and no line for the first paragraph of the moratorium, to change the first Prop 2.5 question so that the word road comes out of where it is now and gets added to the end as improvements to roads, to add to take the slash out between Snow Fighter and dump truck and put comma A, and that's it. We have a motion to
Just this. To correct what you said, it was not additional yes no is not on a temporary moratorium, it's on a permanent ban.
It's on the moratorium. Oh, I'm sorry,
it's on the permanent ban.
Okay. It's a prohibition.
As opposed to a temporary moratorium, which I think is an oxymoron.
Okay. Ready? We have a motion?
So moved.
Okay. We have a second on that motion?
Second.
Okay. All in favor of doing that? All opposed? Okay. There you go. Sorry, Rick.
I know.
He's awake now.
All right. Let's see. That worked out. Everybody's okay with that?
Yeah.
Consideration of 2017 annual town meeting warrant articles. Is there more we need to consider on these today, David?
No, the only two, we just wanted to tell you that I'm going to try to have the planning board come in and talk to you about the Knollcrest on the 13th.
Okay.
And then you could take your next steps after that.
But is there a planning board report?
Well, I think they would be coming in to give.
David, did you say we are supposed to have a hearing for Knollcrest also?
We have a public hearing scheduled for the 13th.
Yeah, okay.
We advertise, yeah.
Yes.
And that will be here?
Yes.
The planning board. That was confusing the way you said that.
It's a joint meeting with the planning board for a hearing, is that what you're saying?
No, we'll invite them to come in.
They're coming to our hearing?
You wanted to hear from them before you did anything, so that's why I was pointing out that the planning board is going to be here so you can proceed after that.
Their report in advance?
Yes, we have. I spoke to Gino about that.
That's what I was looking for, was the report.
And then the only other article is the personnel admin plan that has gone through so many word processors. It's not fun to work with anymore.
No, what we decided we were going to do with that one was if it's ready in time for the advisory's last meeting, then they may change their recommendation, but otherwise it's a no-action recommendation.
Yep. So what you have is the complete redline version, okay. And then what I emailed you in the PDF on Tuesday was the new version, all clean, the redline version, and the old version. So you have all three versions of it. But and then there are three slides at the beginning summarizing what the changes were.
Okay.
And I understand they're not doing the classification plan?
We're still working on the classification plan, but there are no amendments to the classifications in this. But we do have from town council an opinion that the personnel board has the authority to update that and bring it to the next, whenever, next town meeting.
My question was, are we doing that at this town meeting?
You're not doing the classification plan at this town meeting.
All right, so we're only going to do the bylaw.
Yes.
And I had some things that I would question in here. Like one of the items when there's some serious internal employee complaints, those go to the town administrator and the chair of the personnel board. We never find out about them.
Well, I think currently, I mean, you'd have to go back and look at the original one. Those complaints go to the personnel board, and they're allowed to assign anyone to handle the complaint.
Yeah, no, I'm in favor of the change to include the town administrator. I'm just wondering why we could not, why can't there be a reference in here that the Board of Selectmen be notified? So let's say we have two department heads, and one department head files a complaint against the other department head, and there's a war going on between two department heads. Under this system, we never find out about it.
Can you tell me where you're at?
Well, I take page 18, bottom paragraph. So if there's a complaint against the town administrator, who works directly with us, the town administrator shall report to the chair of the personnel board that a complaint has been made. And then we go on with the procedure for the personnel board to be involved with, but we never find out. And the same thing is with a number of other
there was, I think at one point there was an edit that anywhere that you saw the chair of the personnel board, that it was also the chair of the Board of Selectmen.
It should be the vice chair.
I would have to go
with that. That would be an acceptable change, but I don't see that.
It doesn't look like it was actually made.
Yeah, it was never made.
Yeah, no, it was discussed and taken out.
I'm not saying that we should get involved in investigating and everything else, but I think it's something we need to know what's going on. So if a resolution is that...
Here it is. It's at the end of this paragraph on page 19. Paul, you find out about it after the investigation.
After the investigation.
Right. That's what it says.
Yeah, the second full paragraph on page 19.
If it applies to the town administrator, then the employee reports it to the chair of the personnel board, who consults with town council and the chair of the board of selectmen. And then there's an investigation. So it does, as far as the town administrator goes, it covers the board of selectmen. For the other types of complaints, it looks like it doesn't cover the board of selectmen. Anyway, I don't think we can negotiate this or...
Yeah, and I want to see the definition of employee in the bylaw, because the Fair Labor Standards Act uses that definition, and if it's too broad, if it applies to part-time employees, then this FLSA section, the Fair Labor Standards Act section, needs to be redone. I don't think this is ready for review.
So have we had Labor Council review this?
But yeah. Because he had a few edits on it. Other than that, he's been fine with it. Nick Anastasopoulos, an attorney, and Julia Jacobson both have made their edits,
so Nick's
and the planning board
this.
Voted it.
Okay.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Nick's been reviewing this.
That's
this is good. I'm not saying not to go forward with it. All I'm saying is, as a policy matter, I want to see the Board of Selectmen better informed.
Yeah, I think
things
I think
that are going on in
before,
town.
If you look at the wording in red that was striked out.
What page?
Just on 18 and 19 references, like the second paragraph from the bottom on page 18. Previously it said, if an employee would like to file a complaint, the employee may do so by contacting any of the following individuals whose contact info can be found on the town's website: town administrator, or any individual member of the Board of Selectmen, or any individual member of the personnel board. And then it went on.
That's a bad process. Then everybody's involved.
Yeah. And then the next step was the chair of the personnel board will appoint an appropriate citizen of the town to investigate the matter on behalf of the town. So you still didn't get to the board of selectmen until there was a report to give.
I just would like to see, as a policy matter, that the board get notified when a complaint is filed against any of our direct appointees.
I think that's easily added, and I don't see that there's any problem with that, and I don't think that they would have any issue with that either.
You're not talking about just sexual harassment, any kind of complaint, right?
Yes. I mean, I had one town where the parties agreed on a stay away order that two people would never be in the same room at the same time. And there was never told to the Board of Selectmen, who was inviting people to come to the same place at the same time for meetings. They didn't know that there was this thing. So always somebody was missing, wasn't showing up. And it wasn't that they weren't doing their job, it's just they had reached an agreement that no one ever told the board about.
Well, the complaint processes that are in here are just equal employment and sexual harassment.
Yep. Okay, good. Anything more? Everybody in general agreement with Paul's point about some information to the selectmen? Yeah.
Okay.
I agree.
All right, so let's move on. Anything else on
so
these?
So what would be the process on this? They're going to continue to draft it?
I mean,
they think they're done, right?
Yeah, they think they're done.
So we're waiting for advisory to decide if they're going to...
They took no action at the last meeting.
And they may change that.
Right. Okay. They're probably waiting for us also to say it's done.
Yeah, I think anything from this point, because the advisory, you know, motion and everything is going to go out, would have to be some sort of amendment to whatever motion at town meeting.
Right. Yeah, and they're going to have a meeting before town meeting.
But I don't want to change the document that's sitting online anymore. I'd like to just make the edits and distribute to personnel and advisory that they recommend it.
Okay, sounds good. What's next?
So we're not going to take any vote on this at all at this time? All right.
It's up to the board. It's on the agenda if you want to. It's on the agenda as town meeting warrant articles.
Well, the part I read, I'm
we're happy. He's asking for amendments. Should we just see if they can make the amendments and then we
see a final? I'd like to see a final clean version. I don't really care what it says that's different from what it said before. I don't know what it said before.
Well, you have that.
Yeah, but that's what I mean. Once it's all done.
Well, I don't know if it's ever done. They've been doing this since 1988. Every year, it's something different. It seems like. But
okay.
I would not expect to make any more.
Is there some other town that has a really good one? We could just cross out Holliston or whatever and write Sherborn. I mean, why does it take since 1988 to rewrite a personal plan?
What's so unique about us?
It just contains the same things other ones do, but
okay. Change
the language instead of scrapping the whole thing and replacing it.
All right. I mean, it looks like a lot of work. I'm sure there was a lot of thought that was put into it. Let's maybe on the 13th we can vote this if we've got the little change that Paul just asked for in and anything else that anybody gives you, David.
Well, what if I make a motion to give initial approval to what's been presented with the amendment that was discussed.
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Why are we giving initial approval?
Because I think advisory wants to know whether we want to go forward.
It definitely would be helpful.
So they want to know before the 13th because they have another meeting?
Yeah, and it's, under the bylaw, the personnel board is charged with enforcing the personnel admin plan, and then you guys appoint the personnel board.
Right.
So it would help going to advisory that there was some sort of vote of support.
I'm going to defer to the people who know more about these things.
I would say yes. I'm very grateful that the personnel board has put all this effort into it. And we've had town council do a lot of work, and I can see in some of the changes that the old plan is obsolete in many ways. I mean, they were talking in here about how harassment can only occur between a supervisor and a subordinate. And that's not the law at all anymore. You can have harassment between employees at the same level. So this is a necessary step in modernizing language that's dated. Laws moved on, the courts have moved on in their decisions. So it's good. My only concern was the practical one of trying to administer a small government without the Board of Selectmen knowing what the people weren't talking to each other or couldn't talk to each other.
Anybody else?
I would have to abstain. I have not had a chance to really digest this enough to make an intelligent vote on it.
It's kind of how I feel.
So you want to hold off?
I mean, the advisory was ready to wait until the fall. We pushed them to do something about it.
Then so. I won't spend any more time on it.
Oh, I mean, it's been kind of creeping along forever, so
yeah,
if it's either ready or it's not ready.
It's ready. I said it's ready. It's okay. Done. I sent you out the copy. Right. The only amendment known sitting out there is the one that Paul just made.
All right, so then let's put it on the agenda for the 13th for a vote. And if somebody, personnel or somebody wants to come in and give us a little synopsis of what they changed so the public kind of understands what was changed, which might be helpful for a town meeting, then that would probably be good too.
Right. The first three slides on the PDF are the summary of what is the items that have changed.
Okay. All right. Any Anything else? What's our next? Our next item is town administrator report.
Last time we had given out a draft CM&D director job description that just had some basic items on it. Now we've reworked it and put it into the format.
Yep. I'm going to recuse myself.
So this isn't, the expectation is for the board to work on this, and then once the board approves it, take it to the personnel board for approval, and then post the position for the permanent filling of the position. So I don't expect, it would be nice if you check this out between now and April 13th, and then send me your comments or edits.
Well, I did have a chance to look at it a little bit, and I see that it accomplishes what we had wanted, which was under job summary. It says the position requires the director to keep all town buildings, facilities, and grounds under the Board of Selectmen. You probably want to say, requires the director to maintain rather than to keep all the buildings under the jurisdiction of the Board of Selectmen.
Can we feed David back comments between now and the next meeting?
Is that on the first page?
Page one. This job summary, fourth line. It's just a verb is missing there. Position requires the director to keep all town buildings, facilities, and grounds under the Board of Selectmen. I would say to maintain.
I can't even find
instead of keep.
Which line under job summary?
Hey, David, when you've got them going out to bid, David, when you've got the CM&D director going out to bid, is that in addition to your role as the procurement officer?
No.
Maintain takes care of it.
It's not assigning procurement authority to the CM&D director. So everything still has to go through the chief procurement officer.
So when you say go out to bid, it's more informal that they would still
they put their bid documents together and they review the bids when they come back. But they can't sign off.
Why don't we just say prepares and reviews bids?
I agree.
Can you tell me where
that is?
That's okay. You know what? We can do this offline since we're not
voting
on tonight.
Which bullet point is it?
It's the fifth bullet point on the second page. It should say solicit quotes or prepares bid documents and reviews bids.
Now we're on the same page and bullet point.
Let's be on the same page.
So I guess we are going to do this. We're going to edit it here and then just vote it. Is that what people want to
well,
do?
Well, what's more important than this job description is what we're going to do in the next 5 or 6
days. Yes, you should present those options.
The final day of Ed Wagner is April 7th. So as of Monday, I'm going to kind of have Ed take a back seat, and we'll be relying on the foreman, which under contract is responsible in the absence of the CM&D director. And so we'll do that through the week and use Ed to iron out anything that comes up or try to transition whatever we can. Earlier in the week, I posted an interim director of community maintenance and development position in case we want to go that route. I posted it as open until filled, salary depending on qualifications, and that the position has no claim on the permanent position when that's permanently posted and hired into. So we can have we just need to know what process the Board of Selectmen wants to do for an interim person and a full person. So what I was hoping and trying to expedite it would be to get to authorization from the board to put somebody in the interim position. And if you want the name to come back before they're actually placed in there, we could probably get a name back to you on the 13th.
Okay. Is that your recommendation?
That's my recommendation. If you don't do this, then we just rely on the contract, which is puts the foreman in charge.
I think it's a good idea.
Yeah, makes sense to me.
Makes sense.
So bring back a name.
Yep.
For an interim.
But you posted this interim position?
Yes.
Okay with that?
Yep, absolutely. Okay.
Thanks, David. Thanks for
good idea.
Thanks yeah. for working this out.
Sure.
Appreciate him taking initiative on that.
So for long term, we just want to finalize this job description and get the permanent position posted.
I think the job description is ready to be voted. Is it on the agenda? So is it noticed on the agenda sufficiently that we can do that?
This is for the second job description. That's what you're talking about?
Yeah.
For the yeah. permanent job description.
For the permanent.
The job description's on here, yeah.
Yeah.
It's on the agenda.
I'd move approval.
Second.
With edits?
Yeah, with edits.
I think
you.
Mark had said he wanted more time to review it.
Well, hang on a second.
I thought it was the personnel plan that he wanted to...
Can we go through and say what the edits are, just so we're all clear?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
On the second line under job summary, change keep to maintain. And on the fourth bullet point on page 2, to amend it to read solicits quotes and prepares bid documents for HVAC generator, blah, 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 blah.
All right, I've got more changes than that, so. So let's start with job summary.
Sorry, Rick.
Job summary, paragraph 1. The second line, the word land managements should have the S deleted.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
At the end of that line, you added the word maintain instead of keep. That's fine.
Yeah.
On the one, two, three, fourth line, the second word in with, delete that. After the word facilities, same line, put a comma. At the end of the next to last line of that paragraph, add an S to public ground. Paragraph 2, when you're ready, the next to last bullet that starts with prepares applications, where it says federal and state, just put a after state dash funded, hyphen funded, highway construction projects. On the next page, we got the one on the fifth bullet point that Chuck read, right? Solicits quotes.
And
prepares bid documents and reviews. And then the last bullet on that section, instead of both positions require, it should say this position requires frequent right. contact, etc. And then now, when you say the successful candidate will and the successful candidate shall, are those minimum requirements? Are those aspirational? What are those?
They're, anything less than this, you would have to document some sort of waiver for while you're not meeting that minimum specification.
Okay. And that's the same with all the licenses, et cetera.
The first line in section 3 doesn't make sense to me.
And normally, a valid Massachusetts CDL Class 2A hoisting engineer's license may require...
A
Class A CDL and or special licenses such as bucket truck, catch basin cleaner, street sweepers, and other specialized equipment.
Okay, so change the comma after engineering license to semicolon.
But may require, seems to me we either require it or we don't.
Good point.
Yeah.
Hiring them.
Or you could say preference to those applicants who have Class A CDL licenses. Do we really want the director of CMD to be...
I could say...
Street sweeping license?
Yeah.
Just say
I
other...
I think you just say
other preferred licenses.
To cover all of our equipment.
Other preferred licenses?
Yeah.
SACDL and our specialized, it's just a bucket trick.
Well, some
preferred
of the,
or desirable.
Some of the requirements, right? You want them to have the CDL and the Class B and the Class 2A hoisting engineer's license, right?
Yes, that's the first clause. We're dividing this into two clauses. One
you,
is...
You need a Class A to operate any of the equipment that we have?
Well, it says you have to have a Class B.
Right, he's talking about the Class A where it says Class A commercial driver.
So, Class A, I think, is heavier equipment.
Yeah, right. I think the Class B is what everybody has, and if they don't have it, then you have to get it within 6 months.
So I guess the question is, does this additional list of licenses do anything for this position that is helpful?
No, I should take that whole second half of the sentence and make it a preference somewhere, but not as a...
Preference or desired or desirable?
Yeah. And put it under the... desirable skills licenses include...
Wow, wouldn't it be nice to get a licensed professional engineer? That would be awesome. We have so many engineering needs in this town. We don't have a town engineer.
So under education, training, and experience, it would just say valid Massachusetts CDL Class B, Class 2A hoisting engineer's license, period.
Yep, good.
Yep.
Thanks. All right, so we had a motion to approve, right?
Are there any grants that we would be looking for this individual to seek?
Yeah, I mean, Chapter 9.
Maybe it's in here and I missed it, but...
Chapter 9 is
beyond,
a grant.
Beyond that.
Yeah, I mean, they... Everybody should be looking at all funding sources.
Smart streets, what's that rural?
Requesting as needed road. Funding for mandated projects, does that cover that? I don't
know. It could come to us. We want to go to somewhere else.
No, what is it that you want it to explicitly say?
Well, the police chief does a good job of coming up with grants. The fire chief comes up with grants. If there's grants available, I think we want to put in here. We expect them to go, him or her, to go after them.
I like that.
That's in the fire department, the fire chief's PD.
Is it?
Yep.
Expected to maximize alternative funding sources, which is...
Sounds good.
Yes.
Yeah, great suggestion.
Right. So what's the wording?
It would be under job duties, a new item.
And I guess you're going to tell me in municipal law we can't add and all other duties that are assigned by the Board of Selectmen?
Yes, you can. Okay.
That should be on there then.
As long as you have a comma in front of the and. Did you see that article this week? I'll tell you about it later.
These are great ideas.
Yeah, it needs to be in there.
So what's your expected to language, Mark? Do we have that?
It says other duties and responsibilities as assigned.
Maximize the ultimate funding source.
Assigned by...
Such as grants, state grants.
Okay.
Let's see what the language is. Could you read the grant language?
Expected to maximize alternative funding sources such as grants is what I have, but...
That's great.
That's good.
Perfect.
Then other duties / responsibilities as assigned by Board of Selectmen.
Under contacts and four.
Let me put special projects in there. projects, duties, responsibilities as assigned by Barstool.
Yes.
Is that heading on the very bottom of page one where it says facilities director responsibilities? What is that? Just those three words at the very bottom.
Director is on call. Respond to various after normal warrants. Oh, that was supposed to be in
the second box.
It should have come back at the top.
Just come out.
All right, so can we pick that out?
Yeah.
Paul, you had one?
Yeah, on the bottom of the second page.
Yeah.
Don't you want one of his contacts to be the town administrator?
Yes.
Maybe the first contact?
How about the assistant town administrator?
And the assistant, yeah. Put her first.
Isn't another, I mean, I don't know how much you have to do this, but it would also be state highway officials, right? About for the grants and things like that?
Yes. Mass Highway. Mass DOT.
State, local, and Fed officials.
That works closely with Mass.
Okay, so yeah, you've got it up there, so you don't need to put it underneath. All right, I think we're good. Right? Can we take a vote?
Hang on a second. What about emergencies? Right, doesn't he?
Director's on call, maybe he's subject to respond to emergencies after normal working hours.
That's fine.
This is good, David.
Move approval as amended.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor? All right, great.
Nice job.
I don't know if that's...
You're good at it.
If that helps you. I think you've got them all there, David, already. Okay, so that was good. Now it's Clean Sherborn Day. So Clean Sherborn Day is 429,
right? What about the assistant job description?
Do you want this posted?
That wasn't the CM&D one? Yeah, absolutely.
So take it right to the personnel board, have them approve it, and then post it. Okay.
Yeah. Well, this isn't even on the agenda.
Yeah, this is the one that we really needed to get done. It's the other... The assistant town administrator has no job description. So we were trying to take care of that and update mine so that there's no conflict.
Either has no job description or her job description is everything.
It's all encompassing.
All right.
Loosely defined.
So this will be on a future agenda?
Yeah. Clean Sherborn Day. What's that all about, David?
Clean Sherborn Day is the, I'm not sure who came up with the title, but it's Sherborn Cleanup Day on April 29th. So we were going to have CM&D do some pre-cleaning down at Farm Pond so that people could clean up that area on that Saturday. And usually we have, they can pick up bags and stuff and drop them off at the side of the road, that kind of thing. There'll be more information going out.
Last year there was a really good turnout, not at Farm Pond, but here, and the amount of trash is just unbelievable. I did about half of Maple Street, and it was four or five large trash bags that were just filled. It was about half of it was McDonald's and Dunkin' Donuts trash. So
half of it was stuff from my street that I went and dumped on your street.
I wanted to talk to you about that. Yeah. But it's a lot of volunteers, and it really does pick up a lot of trash in town.
No, it's a great service for the town. Okay, selectmen items. Anybody have anything? Somebody can ask Paul, Sean to come back in if he wants to. Any selectmen have any selectmen items? No? Next meetings we have scheduled are April 13th and then April 25th, which is the night of town meeting, right?
Yes.
Okay. Consideration of minutes. So Diane is clicking away at these minutes.
I made the changes that followed when great. I was on vacation, so those are all done.
Yeah, I've reviewed them very carefully. I'd move approval of the January 5th and January 26th, 2017 minutes.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor? Approving those minutes? That's fantastic. Now we've got a executive session. Do you have my
my crib sheet here, Diane, for the executive session. You got it, great, thanks. I move that the Board of Selectmen enter into executive session under Chapter 38, Section 21A23 to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, updates on the school contract negotiations. The board will not return to public session. The chair declares that having these discussions in open session may have a detrimental effect on the outcome. I need a second and a roll call vote.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Killeen. Having a second, we now have a roll call vote. Mr. Killeen.
Aye.
Mr. Brandon.
Yes.
Mr. Yon.
Yes.
Mr. Durensis.
Aye.
And I'm also aye. Having passed by a vote of 5-0, we are now in executive session.